Hello everybody and welcome to an updated version of my Open Broadcaster software tutorial. For those who don't know, as it's stated here, Open Broadcaster software is a free and open source software for video recording and live streaming, and it is a very, very recommendable program for both of these purposes. Not only because it's free, but it is highly customizable, it is high performance, and it does not drain as many system resources like other programs such as Fraps, for example. Since the last time I made a tutorial for this program, things have changed, many things for the better, and the GUI of the program has changed a little bit. They have added new options, etc. So I'm going to go through the entire program from scratch. So we're going to start off right from the beginning. So of course, first things first is you download the program for Windows. This is the latest one. Currently there's also development going on this OBS multi-platform release, which is planned to support all kinds of different platforms, not only Windows but also Linux and Mac OS. So currently if you're a Windows user, I'm going to make this tutorial for the Windows version. Go ahead, download it, install it, and the program comes with two different executables, 32-bit and 64-bit. And unless you are still running on a 32-bit OS, there is no reason why you should not run the 64-bit application. It is better in every regard. It handles larger video file sizes better, it's faster, etc. So unless you really have a good reason to use the 32-bit application, always run it 64-bit. So let's dive right into it. This is the graphical user interface as it looks like when you open up the program. So what you have here is a couple of drop-down menus, file, you can save your presets here, you can open the folder where you're saving your video files here, etc. All sorts of different options. Currently at this point doesn't make much sense going over it. Let's just start off first with this here. We have a preview screen here where you can pretty much just preview whatever you are about to record, just to make sure that it's really recording the game and not just recording your audio on the black screen. Another interesting part of the GUI is this here. You have scenes and sources. This is really important. Coming from the live streaming kind of corner, you can set up different scenes that you can switch from and to while you are recording. For example, when I'm live streaming, let's say Battle of Stalingrad, I've chosen Battle of Stalingrad here because the preview screen works quite well with it, unlike with Cliffs of Dover, where the game is basically split into two graphical adapters, and you can either record the graphic user interface or the game itself, not both at the same time. So I'm using Battle of Stalingrad this time around to highlight my points. So, as said, you can make scenes here, and what this does, for example, I have here one scene including an image. So when I'm live streaming, I'm starting here with this opening screen saying Battle of Stalingrad live streaming by Jagdgeschwader of Fear. So this is usually when I'm just getting into the game and there's nothing doing yet, I'm displaying this intro screen. Then usually I have a sort of a break image when I'm just taking a little break between sorties, and an end screen. And the more important one is here, this is the actual game capture scene. So you can set up hotkeys for these. I currently have none set because I haven't been live streaming Battle of Stalingrad in a while, and I've reconfigured the program lately to make use of the new features of OBS. So, but basically, what you want if you're live streaming is you set up hotkeys. It's best to use some kind of combination like Alt plus a number. You don't want to have your scene on just a single button, because it's very easy to accidentally press the wrong one and you end up recording something you don't want to. So best off having a two-button combination. For when you're recording offline and you just want to record footage via different scenes, the only thing you really want is the game capture. So far for the scenes and sources, we are going to come back to this later on. What's also interesting here is on the right hand side you have direct influence in your volume control. This is for the microphone in percentage, and this is for your speakers, so what you are hearing. We have a couple of buttons that are of interest. Here you can actually start a preview that will display what you are actually recording. Here's a recording button that will actually start the recording, or if you are in live streaming mode, you have a respective button that says start streaming here. But I'm currently using a profile that I use to record footage locally. So this is it for the main screen. Let's dive right into this settings section. So we have a language select screen here. That's fairly straightforward what that is. You can give your profile a name here, or if you want to make a duplicate of this, you just kind of like rename it and then you press add, or you can actually rename it as such. Notification area icon is basically just this here. So when you have this enabled, it will show up in the info label here. Minimize the notification area is just if you minimize the program, it will not show up here. It will just show up here. It's just personal preference. Then enable cursor over projector. This means this will dictate whether or not you will be able to see your mouse cursor in the video. This is also personal preference. I like to leave this on. Show log window on OBS launch. This is probably just for advanced users. It just opens up the last created log whenever you start up the program, but for your average user this is not of any interest. So let's continue the encoding. We have a couple of very interesting options here. First of all, encoder. There are three choices: X264, QuickSync, and NVIDIA NVENC. I recommend using X264, and for a couple of reasons. This needs a little bit of explaining. X264 is a CPU-based encoder that's used for creating MP4 files, and it uses mostly the CPU, so you ought to have a powerful CPU like an i5, i7 or a comparable AMD CPU. If you have a very powerful graphics card, you may also use NVIDIA NVENC instead. This mostly uses the GPU for encoding, but the downside is that for the same encoding bitrate as specified here, NVIDIA NVENC is always going to be inferior in image quality to X264. X264 quality-wise is the best option available. It depends whether or not you are bottlenecked by the CPU or the GPU, which one is probably going to be the best for you. But if you're not really sure, I recommend staying with x264. We also have a third option here, which is currently grayed out because I cannot take advantage of it. This is quick sync. You have to meet a few requirements to make use of this. What quick sync is you need a relatively new Intel CPU, an i5 or i7 with on-chip graphics acceleration. And not only that, you also need a main board that supports it. I do have a CPU that supports it, but not a main board that makes use of QuickSync. And basically what this does is it uses the CPU onboard graphics for encoding and thus frees up the CPU and the GPU for encoding. This sounds quite nice, but similarly to NVENC, the image quality is inferior to x264 for the same bitrate. So if you're going for highest possible image quality, then always use x264. Okay, let's continue. Use CVR. This is also a very important option because there are two ways you can actually record in OBS. That's either using CVR or VBR. CVR stands for constant bitrate and means that the program will always record at this specified bitrate. The video is always going to be like this, which is it has its upsides and its downsides. The advantage is the quality of the video is going to stay absolutely constant, and what's also interesting or important to note about CVR, if you're live streaming on say Twitch or a comparable site, they require by now that you use CVR, and they also require you to not go above 3500 KB per second. So if you're live streaming, I recommend you use CVR. If you're doing local recording, you have the option between CVR or VBR. The difference of VBR as compared to CVR is that by unticking this, you're actually going to VBR. The difference is that the program, based on this quality balance setting, is going to adjust the bitrate of the video on the fly according to what's going on the screen. So this is going to reduce overall video file size. So if you want to end up with smaller videos with just a minor image quality loss, then go for VVR. Unfortunately, VBR is going to have a lower image quality than CVR, basically just because of artifacts that appear when there's a lot of action going on, especially in very sort of fast-paced games. You will notice that whenever there's a lot of motion going on, you'll get like a blur of artifacts. If you want to be conservative of your system resources and you want to your video file size to be as small as possible, use VBR. If you're going for a maximum quality approach, use CVR. I personally prefer using CVR for most purposes, but if I'm flying online, for example, I usually go for VBR. I recommend you leave this on. This is a default setting. Don't tinker with it unless you know what you're doing. I also recommend you leave this as it is. Don't use custom buffer size. You can tinker around with this if you know what you're doing. Otherwise, stay away. The next thing that's important is the bitrate. This is probably the most direct control we have over the image quality of your video. Rule of thumb is the higher the bitrate, the higher the quality, because the encoder just gets more file size to play around with. The more file size it gets, the more information it can actually fit into the video, and the better the image quality goes. Now, of course, this is you probably will have to make a compromise, especially if you are live streaming. Most live streaming sites like Twitch, they have an upper limit for what you can actually load onto the server, and that currently is, if I'm not mistaken, 3500 kb per second, and you're not allowed to exceed that, otherwise you're going to have quality issues with your stream. You're going to have lagged frames, you will be having stutters, etc. Also, another limitation for live streaming in terms of bitrate is, of course, not everybody or not every one of your viewers has the bandwidth to actually view a video that's streaming at 3500 kb per second. So it's in terms of live streaming, it's not always the best to aim at the highest possible bitrate. I would recommend you stay between 2500 and 3000 kb per second, just to be in the safe side. Of course, if you're locally recording, you are not hamstrung by any bandwidth restrictions, and you can up this to any value you deem useful. I currently have this set for a 1080p recording profile at 5000. You of course can go higher. 5000 kbps, 1080p I'm currently using whenever I'm flying online and I'm recording, and this is a good compromise between image quality and system performance. Okay, so this was quite an excursus, but a very important section of OBS. Next up, audio encoding. This is more straightforward. You have a choice between two codecs, MP3 and AAC. I recommend you use AAC because it's much better quality-wise. I recommend going for a bitrate of 160. I would choose a format of 44.1 kHz and set the channels to stereo. Next up, broadcasting settings. As said, this profile right here is for local recording, so this is set to file output only. If you're live streaming, you need to set this to live streaming, but more on that later. So what's important here, if you're recording locally, you need to set up a file path. So this is my file path. This goes into the video folder on my PC. I've got a custom folder for that OBS recordings, and it's going to name the video file record.mp4. And whenever I'm making a new video, of course the previous one does not get overwritten, but OBS is smart enough to actually rename the next one record 01, record 02, etc. What's also interesting here, replay buffer. This is a relatively new setting, and it works kind of like shadow play with NVIDIA, in that you can set up a buffer in seconds, and whenever you start your recording, OBS will save, like, if you set this to 100 seconds, the last 100 seconds of action that you have played, and so to say, you can record things in the past. So when if you don't want to record your entire game session, but just like interesting parts of it, did you come across during the play? You just record using this buffer feature. I haven't tried it out myself. It's really just some kind of gimmick. I don't think that most people will make use of that anyways. So this is for local recording. I'm going to jump into a live streaming profile here where I can show off my settings for live streaming. So this is set to live stream now. Stream service, I have chosen Twitch. I've got a Twitch account. You can also choose from these here, for example YouTube or what have you. What you need to do then is also choose your nearest stream server. This depends on where you're at. And I think there is on for Twitch there is some part on the homepage where you can actually look up which one of those servers has the smallest latency for you. So I've got this set to Frankfurt because I'm near Germany. Then, very important, for this to work you need to know your stream key. Anybody who has a Twitch account gets a stream key for their channel, and you need to figure this out. If you don't know yours, just Google for stream key Twitch or whatever and find your stream key, paste it in here. What the stream key does is you should never give this out to anybody else, because then with the stream key anybody is able to stream content onto your channel. This is pretty much telling OBS which way to send any of its data. So don't give this out to people you don't trust and don't know. Other options here: auto reconnect. Should you lose connection to your to the Twitch server, then this is going to try and automatically reconnect with the server, and this this here tells the program how many tries it should go for. Then here you have a delay option. This pretty much determines well, pretty much what it says: a delay between your own game and when it's going to show up on the streaming service. Now, some may wonder what reason is behind all of that. Well, it's basically to prevent stream ghosting. So some people get their kicks out of stream cheating, which basically means they are watching you play, and because of them watching you play, they know what you are doing and they're using that against you. And to counteract that, you can set up a delay here. It's personal preference. I mean, for smaller channels it's probably not going to be much of an issue, but the option is there and you can make use of that. If you're having network problems, you can try and minimize network impact, but as said previously, you have to figure out a bitrate that's suitable both for the streaming service and for you. I forgot to mention that you also of course need to adjust this to your own upload bandwidth. So if you have a 3000 kbps upload bandwidth and you're playing online, you have to keep in mind that you need a good portion of your bandwidth for the game. So good rule of thumb is you need to keep 20% of your uploading bandwidth reserved for gaming, otherwise you'll get all sorts of lag issues, etc. When you're live streaming, you can also save the video file locally, so you can pretty much do both a live stream and a local recording at the same time, and you get the same replay buffer options. Okay, so I'm going to continue with my local recording profile, and we are now in the video tab. This is where you select what to record from, and this should actually show your graphics card, and then you've got the choice either to set the resolution that you're recording with or choose a monitor. As I'm running on a single monitor, there's not really much to choose from. I'm just taking my native monitor resolution, and that's good. Another option here, resolution downscale. This is most important for live streaming, but it can also be useful when you're recording locally and you want to minimize the system performance degradation. So what this does is, even if you're playing at say 1080p, you can choose this to downscale the output video. There are a couple of options, and for example, if you want to record at 720p and you're playing at 1080p, you choose this here, resolution downscale 1.5, and it's going to record all of this, and it's not going to cut off anything of the video, it's just going to kind of resize the entire video. This is important, as said, for live streaming, because you are limited by the bandwidth we have set up here. For live streaming, as said, don't go above 3000 or 3500, and 1080p with a bitrate of 3500 might not look all that good. So you're better off when you're live streaming to downscale to 720p when using a bitrate like 3000 kbps. It's going to look much better, simply because the same bitrate is used for a small amount of pixels. And when you're using a downscale, you can also use a filter. I recommend using this only when you're doing this for an offline recording, because many of the streaming sites are not really happy about getting a filtered video input, because that means more processing on their part, and this might lead also to stream issues. So when you're live streaming, leave this on bilinear, don't go higher than that. If you're a local recording, you can go all the way down to Lancash, and that should provide you with the best image quality. Then next setting, FPS. Of course, this determines at what kind of frame rate the video is recording, and I recommend leaving this at 30 for a number of reasons. For example, YouTube will automatically downscale any video to 30 FPS. So if you're recording at like 60 FPS and you're uploading this on YouTube, you won't get any benefit out of it, because YouTube is currently limiting the frame rate for videos at 30 FPS. Some of the streaming sites like Twitch, I think they allow you to stream at 60 FPS, but you will have to look that up yourself, because I don't know all the quirks of all the streaming sites around. Also, this FPS setting does have a direct impact on the system performance hit that you're taking while recording. Going to higher frame rate recording will have a higher impact on your CPU or whatever you are using for encoding. So the higher you go, the more of a performance hit you take. So you have to try this out yourself and see what's working well for you, but as said, I recommend 30 FPS. That should be good to go. We have another option here, disable aero. And this also needs a little bit of explaining. You have a few ways to record footage. If you're recording a game, you should preferably go for game capture, because that's basically just the best in terms of overall performance. It's going to draw the least system resources. Now, provided some games have their issues and they cannot be captured, especially if they are not DirectX, if you have like an OpenGL game or something more exotic than that, you won't be able to record via OBS with game capture. In this case, what you can do is you can run the game in windowed mode. You go and use a window capture as your capturing source, and in that case, when you're using window capture, you need to disable arrow. This also applies if you're using monitor capture. Whenever you're using window or monitor capture, disable arrow. Okay. Next tab is audio. So this is pretty much straightforward. You just tell OBS what to use as audio input. I've set this as I'm using a gaming headset. I'm using this as my speaker input, and this is my microphone. Show only connected devices is pretty much logic. Just shows you what is currently attached to your PC. There are a couple of other options here. You can boost the volume of your microphone and your speakers here. One means 100%, so this is 100% of the volume. You can go higher than this if you like. You have a push to talk delay here. When you're using, when you're using a microphone to record, you can use either push to talk or open mic. So open microphone will record all of the time, whereas push to talk will only record when you're pushing a specified button. And when you're letting go of that button, you can set up in OBS that it's going to record a certain time after you let go of that button, and I've set this to 200 milliseconds. Again, whatever you want, you can set this up any way you like. Okay, next screen, hotkeys. This is also pretty important. First of all, you can set up here whether you want to use push to talk or open mic for recording. In case you use open mic, you can set up a push to talk key here. You can set up keys to mute and unmute your microphone and your speakers. Then you have here options to start your stream or your recording by hotkeys, and same for the buffer. So similarly as with scenes, I recommend using a two button hotkey combination. So I'm currently have this set to Alt and period, and Alt and Alt and slash and Alt and period. Okay, this is pretty much straightforward. Use whatever you want. Okay, advanced tab. This is where you need to be sort of cautious. For your average user, you shouldn't fiddle around with this too much, because here things can go horribly wrong. First of all, leave this as is. I guess every one of you is using a multi-core CPU. Otherwise, you're not going to be very happy with recording games anyway. So you need at least a dual core, better yet, a quad core CPU. You should usually leave this here, the CPU preset, at very fast. This just basically tells OBS how much of the CPU resources to use for the encoding. This has also a very direct influence both on performance and image quality. But unless you have a really, really good reason for doing this, you should leave this at very fast. Encoding profile. This is mostly of import for live streamers. Some of the live streaming sites, especially YouTube and Twitch, they want you to record with the main encoding profile, not high. For everybody else, if you're recording locally, leave this at high. Also important for live streamers is the keyframe interval. This basically is just something that makes re-encoding for the streaming services a little easier. And for example, YouTube and Twitch, they require you to set this to 2. So whenever you're live streaming, make sure you set this to 2, otherwise leave it at 0. Another option that some of the streaming sites might require is this one. Use CFR. This is basically just a compatibility setting that kind of forces OBS to record at a given frame rate. Unless you really need to use this and you're forced to do this by a streaming service, you can leave this unchecked. We have another window here, quick sync encoder. As I can't make use of this, I can't really tell you much about it. It's basically like the encoding window here, but just for quick sync. As said, I'm not an expert. I've never used it. I simply cannot use it, so I can't comment on this. And last but not least here, microphone noise gate. So when you're using the microphone openly, not push to talk, you can set this up to kind of like work like voice activation. So when you're using your microphone openly, it will only record at a specified value. Again, you just have to tinker around with this. I cannot give you values that will work for everybody. It depends on your microphone and how sensitive it is, and of course how loud the noises around you are and how loud you personally are. Okay, so we've gone through every setting there is, and now it's time to show you how to actually record once you've set up all of this here. As said, for games, it is recommendable to set up a game capture. So, how to do this is you click here, Global Sources, Add, and then you have a bunch of options. For your average game, what you want to go for is Add Game Capture. What this does here, you can give this a name, I'm just going to call it Test. And then it's going to show you a drop-down menu with every application that OBS has found that's currently open and running. And for example, I've currently got IL-2 Battle of Stalingrad running. So what you do is, in this case, you find your game, you choose this, you click OK. And this is now saved for use at a later point. Global sources are something that are globally available, and you can set this up, you can add these to any tab. Otherwise, if you're not using global sources, you will have to set this up manually each and every time. So this pretty much works as a preset for future users. So I've already got a global source for Battle of Stalingrad, and I've added this here. This is my global source game capture. If you've got a game that's not working with game capture for mentioned reasons, either it's maybe running in OpenGL or it's just a pain in the ass, you can use window capture or monitor capture. And as said, you need to disable Aero when using these, simply to improve overall performance. And when you want to use like a webcam, you can add this via video capture device. And you just provide a name and it should show you recording device. This is mine, my Logitech HD webcam, and you've got all sorts of settings to tinker around with this, resolutions, etc., etc. Okay, so we have our scenes here. We have our starting screen, we have our game capture, etc. So when I preview my starting screen, it will be showing my screen over here, and then when I go to game capture, usually before recording I make sure that it's actually correctly hooked into the game. And how you do that is you go to your scene with a game recording, you press preview stream, you go into the game and you back out, and when it's correctly hooked in, you should be seeing the actual game footage here. If you're just seeing a black screen, something has gone wrong, and I, in that case, I recommend you just maybe either delete the game, capture it via global source again and try again, or you set up a new global source entirely. Sometimes it also may help just closing down the program and restarting it, but usually this should capture without problems. Being a Cliffs of Dover pilot for other people flying Cliffs of Dover, what is important is for game capture to work, you need to set up a global source while you are inside the plane. You're not in the GUI, you're not in the settings or any of the screens. You must be sitting in the aircraft, and then you set up your global source as explained. And also when you preview your stream, you have to be sitting in the aircraft, and then you hit preview stream. Otherwise OBS will not be able to find the game and record it. You will be recording a black screen. So always in Cliffs of Dover, make sure you're sitting in the aircraft, then you hit preview stream, you go inside the game, you back out again, and you should be seeing the in-game footage right here. Then you can stop the preview and you can go back into the game, you start your recording via hotkey, and that's it. Okay, so what's left to say? As said, you can set up hotkeys here. Something they've added in since the last video is you can set up scene collections here. So I've got a few here. Battle of Stalingrad, Cliffs of Dover, Rise of Flight. This is quite handy because if you play a lot of games, you will end up with a whole lot of scenes, and you will at some point maybe lose track of all of this. So you, for each and every game, you can set up a scenes list, and this is going to be much easier to use and find the correct sort of scenes collection. Here you can actually quickly select your recording profile. As you can see, I have lots and lots of different profiles. I have different profiles for offline recording and live streaming. I have different profiles for open mic recording and push to talk recording, and for specific games like Alien Isolation, SCP Containment Breach, etc. Okay, I think I have touched up on pretty much everything you probably ought and want to know about OBS. So watching this tutorial, you should now be able to actually record and live stream using OBS, and I hope this has been helpful for you. If there are any more questions or issues, just post in the comments, or if it's a really, really specific problem, you can also of course go to the forums of OBS and leave a message there. They are a very helpful community, and whenever I can't help you personally, just go over there, ask your question, and you should be good to go. Alright, so this video has been going on for quite a while, and I'm going to stop the tutorial here. I hope this has been helpful to all of you, and I'm going to see you in the next video.